हमर ऑनररी डायरेक्टर इन सेंटर फॉर वुमेन स्टडीज इन यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ मैसूर ड्यूरिंग 1994 टू 2002 मैडम कंप्लीटेड बीए एमए एंड पीएचडी इन सोशियोलॉजी इन यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ मैसूर एट प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ सोसाइटी दिल्ली विद दिस ब्रीफ इंट्रोडक्शन ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ सोशियोलॉजी University Kolhapur. I warm welcome to you, madam. Also, we have with us Professor Dai Yoon Jeong from South Korea. Dr. Dai Yoon Jeong is presently the director of Asia Climate Change Education Center based in South Korea. He received a BA and MA degree in Sociology from Korea University, South Korea, and PhD in Environmental Sociology from University of Queensland, Australia. He was a professor of sociology at Jeju National in South Korea from 1981 to 2012 and served as the president of Asia Pacific Sociological Association from 2002 to 2004 and as a delegate of South Korean government of UNFCC and OECD environmental meeting from 2003 to 2005. He published 13 books including environmental sociology and 60 academic research papers in domestic and international journals. Since 2000, he has conducted 15 research projects on environment related projects funded by domestic and international orientation. With this brief introduction on behalf of Department of Sociology, I warm welcome to you, sir. Also, we have with us Professor P.S. Vivek, former professor, Department of Sociology, University of Mumbai. Dr. P.S. Vivek has been a teacher of sociology for over two decades at Mumbai University. He has 27 years of teaching experience at the undergraduate and postgraduate level students in Mumbai. His specialization includes sociology of undergraduate, sociology of management, and sociology of education. Presently, he occupies the position of professor of sociology at sociology department at the University of Mumbai. He has Asiatic Society of India, Mumbai, Indian Sociological Society, New Delhi, Indian History Congress, Delhi, Indian Institute of Public Administration, Delhi, and International Sociological Association, Spain, etc. He has been the recipient of Indo-Shastri Canadian Institute. We have with us Dr. Mohinder Kumar Slaria. He has working as Associate Professor of Sociology. His specialization is Environmental Sociology. He completed BA, MA and PhD in Sociology, MJP, Rohilkhand University, Bareilly, UP. 9 international conferences and 9 national conferences organized by him. 3 major research projects completed by him. He published 8 research papers, international and national journals, as well as books affiliated to member of International Sociological Association and Indian Sociological Association. With this brief introduction on behalf of Department of Sociology, I want welcome to you, sir. Also, I request to former HOD of Department of Sociology, Professor J.B. Ambedkar, sir, for felicitation of the today's chairperson and today's speakers. Chairperson, Professor R. Indira, madam. Dr. Mohinder Slaria, Government College, Chamba, Madhya Pradesh. previous lecture, Department of Sociology, University of Thank you, Professor Ambedkar sir. Thank you very much. Now I hand over charge of the session to chairperson of the session, Professor R. Indira Madam. Madam, please.
Thank you. Good evening to all of you. Well, I understand this is the last session of the day and it's already 5:06. So I don't want to make any speech. I would, you know, the theme of this session is environmental. Interestingly, it also happens to be the theme of the National Conference of the India Sociological Society, which is going to be at the end of this month. And so I would straight away, without taking much time, invite the panelists to make their presentations. I would request you to kindly confine your presentations to about 10 minutes. I'm sorry, but you, I'm sure, understand that we are almost at the end of the day, and given the time constraint, we need to finish it fast. So may I now invite Professor Dal your
बाहर का सुनता है
gentlemen. First of all, I would like to give my deep thanks to Department of Sociology for inviting me. I'm very honored to be here as a speaker. The all of us are the sociologists. Okay, I also sociologists with a special reference to environment. So we call that environmental sociology, focusing on mutual relationship between nature and society. Today, this is the whole outline. I would like to present. Okay. The first one, the agent responding to climate. As you know, the climate change is one of the environmental problems. However, climate change is placed at the top of environmental problems because its seriousness of its impact on nature and human society comparatively very high compared to environmental problems. That's why when we say current environmental problem, the climate change is on the top. Okay, then we can classify at least the 5 agents. Agent is positive. As you know, the first one, natural or local environment. They establish strategy or policies, as you know, the adaptation or the mitigation. And enterprise, as you know, the commercial business and I think the citizens are the major contributors to environmental climate change. For example, the process of resource extraction, process of producing goods and services, and distributing goods and services, the enterprise emitted natural pollution to nature. So nature is a contributor. However, at the moment, the enterprise is a contributor to environmental problem. However, at the moment, they are also a sacrifice because due to the climate change, they got lots of benefit. So at the moment, the commercial enterprise, they are trying to lower green management. I can't get to the light. Okay, green management. Traditionally, the commercial enterprise, they focused on maximizing their profit with less consideration. Then next to the civil organization, NGO, okay, as you know, in sociology, all of us are sociologists. In sociology, we say NGO is an intermediate group between citizen and the government, and between citizen and enterprises. So NGO is a press group to government or enterprise, and educate to citizens. And citizens in their everyday life, they are trying to do the environmental friendly behavior in terms of saving resources and energies, and also they are trying to switch their lifestyle from consumerism to environmentalism. United Nations at the global level developing the climate change. All right, then. So there are some concepts related to the vision, objective, goal, strategy, policy, measure. We have the different terminologies, okay? I think in order to say that, I would like to explain these terminologies. Then next, then desirable approach to establishment of climate change. At least for the case of government and also commercial enterprise and the NGO citizens, according to the agent, we have different policies responding to climate change. However, today my presentation will be focused on government level. Then, for the case of government level, I think at least we need four pages. First one is we have to identify the vulnerability to climate change, for example, in India. Okay. And the next, we have to form the component of policy after identifying the vulnerability to climate change. Next, and we have to decide the policies, decision making. And finally, after we list the potential policies, each policy has different effectiveness, and also each policy requires different budget. So comparing the investment budget and effectiveness from the policies, we have to give priority, which a project should be launched first, like that. That is, analyze the policy effectiveness. I would like the four stages. Then, okay, here, the human on the left side, human activity, that is a source of greenhouse gas emission, okay? Then, it is caused, then we get the climate change, all right? Then, in the box, you can see the first column, exposure to climate change, okay? Then, in India and Korea, for example, we are the two countries can be exposed to the same conditions of climate change. However, the real real impact of climate change is different between India and Korea. Even though two countries are exposed to the same conditions of climate, because there is a sensitivity, a variable called sensitivity to climate change between exposure and real impact. Then, what is the sensitivity? As you can see on the right side, natural adaptation, social adaptation is different between Korea. The natural adaptation, for example, Korea, very mountainous area. India, very plain area. So if we get 200 rainfall in Korea, about 70% they enter into the sea. Only 20% will impact on land. However, India, almost 100% rainfall will impact. This is natural adaptation is different. And also, India and Korea has different the human-made infrastructure. So the vulnerability should be on the basis of real impact. Okay. Then, based on the real impact, we can establish two categories of policy. One is, as you know, adaptation. The other one is mitigation. Mitigation is related to the source of greenhouse gas emission. Adaptation is applied to the changing climate in order to reduce human loss at minimum level. Then, you know, the adaptation policy, in a word, this is a technological approach because focusing on how to adapt to the changed climate, leaving the existing social system as it is, okay? So, relatively low socio-economic cost than implementation of mitigation. And the short-term strategy, so I think it would be effective for delay in the destruction of Earth, but less effective for saving the Earth. Mitigation, this is restructure. Okay, the reconstruction is the major theme of this conference, like that. Which is a existing social structure is structured in a way to maximize material affluence and the convenience as the major cause of current climate change. So, focus on changing existing physical conditions, our body to a new one that inflammation does not come out. So, we call this one social system approach. However, the socio-economic cost much higher than launching adaptation policies long term. Then, in India, for example, on the basis of such a framework, you identify 10 sectors which is vulnerable to climate change, okay? Then, out of the all, we need a lot of money for launching all of the 10 policies. So, we have to select all prior vulnerable. Okay, I mean, 10%, okay. I will present it to you. Okay, the forming here, then, what adaptation, what mitigation policy to be adopted? We have to consider lots of scenes. The next, when we making the decision, we have to adapt the governance system in order to internalize social conflict in advance. Then, this also makes time. Next, please. Okay, then we have to analyze how much money is required for launching a project. For example, we plant the 6,500 hectares in a mountain. Then a total of the budget, 97 billion US. This is the empirical data I conducted in Korea. Then we can estimate the potential reduction quantity. Again, we can estimate how much money we need for reducing 1 ton through each. But then we can identify the policies to be launched with high effectiveness, with low money. Then the function is right for us to decision of policy priority. Then, after we launch all of the project, we also need to analyze how much all project would be effective. Then, this is a model for conducting the project. Then, launching the climate change project, we need lots of money and highly advanced technology. So, if Korea and India is not ready in terms of the availability of finance, availability of technology, you can't do that anything. So what we have to do is carrying capacity building in accordance with launching the policies. This is a list of carrying capacity internal. Next week. And also we have external carrying capacity, because climate change is a global environmental problem. So without very close cooperation with other countries, then the policy effectiveness cannot be higher. That's why we need to build in external capacity, all of this. Okay, that's all. Thank you very much for your listening.
Thank you. May I now request Dr. Hamida Salaya to give this presentation. Thank you.
Very good evening to all. In fact, being a student of sociology and with a specialization in environmental sociology and working on some projects which are based on some focusing on some human dimension of development and climate change. My discussion would be on developmental projects in my state, that is Indian Himalayan region, that is in Himachal Pradesh. My focus will be on one that hydroelectric power developmental based projects in Himachal Himalayas, and with a critical impression of this environmental impact assessments which has been carried out by the many implementers, and the most focus will be on shifting paradigm from need to greed. It is obvious that water is there in Indian Himalayan regions and it can be used just to generate electricity and meet out the all basic necessity of human life. And it is need of the hour just to create many megawatts, gigawatts hydropower. And only 15% has been commissioned so far and 7% is on the way of commissioning, with 22% many things which are coming forward. I will skip this one. The main focus will be this shifting from need-based to greed-based paradigms is a major problem for this sector of development. And being a state Himachal Pradesh, it is called as today electricity state, having more than 400 power projects in a row and affecting millions of people and creating many things. If we see, this is it's all Himalayan region, Indian Himalayan region, which is creating, and this Himachal Pradesh is having almost more than every state the power generation units, and followed by this Uttarakhand and then Uttaranchal and then Jammu Kashmir, whole Himalayan belt, it has been targeted for this steps of development. And if you see, this is the scenario at present, and at present we are having this more than 252 hydropower generation units, and which are in different capacity and different categories, and the maximum this Satluj basin, we do have five rivers, Ravi, Pyas, Satluj and Yamuna in Himachal, and this Satluj basin has good maximum power projects, and followed by this Pyas basin and then Ravi. Comprising three these basins, 72% of total power generation is being created from these rivers basin. If you see, the Arunachal in Indian Himalayan region is the highest which got the maximum number of identified capacity just to generate this hydroelectricity power generation, which is 34% in Himachal is at second number with 13%, and Uttarakhand with 12%, and Jammu Kashmir with 10% of the total maximum potential capacity of India. And if we see, is a condition of the sector, hydro sector, coal is today dominating, and it's followed by this hydropower generation, and then followed by other renewable, then nuclear, then gas, then oil, and at present today, 39,788 megawatt share in the total energy generation in India is contributed by this hydropower generation. If we see the condition of these five rivers, if we can see, it has been highlighted to date, total assessed capacity of these five rivers is 25,000 megawatt. And out of this, more than 6,000 has been commissioned, and 8,000 is on the way of commissioning. And with this 8,000, many questions have been raised, and yet about 11,000 is yet to be commissioned. pressure on this river basin is at a very, very high level. 81% generating capacity in South Asia, India is having, and only 56% of Indian population is having electricity. Over 579 million live without this modern gadgets even today. Per capita is just readable, and I am not going to read everything. And if we see, this is the main basins India is having, and is a condition of all power generation units in Himachal Pradesh. This is the conditions of major five basins in Himachal Pradesh, in Himachal Himalaya. And if you see this yellow line of Yamuna basin, which has again targeted by government of India recently, and another basin is this Ravi basin, sub part of Ravi basin. Because of this, what happened? This whole area of Himachal Pradesh is falling in this seismic zone 4 and 5. And because of this, many locations of this power generation units that fall in category of this zone 5 and zone 4. And this is really a threat, big threat to everything. And if you see, this is the condition zoning 1, 2, and 3, and A, B, and C. And the maximum projects which we are having in this region that is falling in this red highlighted area. And this is the condition of EIA which has been implemented by the executing agencies. You can see the villages, you can see the many villages in both sides of these reservoirs, and they are unsafeguarded, and anyone, animals as well as human being, they can be drawn into the water without any delay, and many deaths have been reported so far because of this attitude of the executor. You can see the dry patch in downstream as well as in the upstream there is a lot of water in form of reservoir, in form of lake, but in the downstream the river is totally dry. You can see this is a case of Chimera 1, which is 540 megawatt power projects, and see it has created 29 kilometer big reservoir, and created it can create havoc. It's a condition of another power project, and silt is there, everything. It is just putting question mark. Once there was a river, and it is disobedience of Honorable Supreme Court of India, which said that at least 11% water is to release just to sustain aquatic life in the downstream, but it's totally being ignored. Once you can see the dumping site, the river becomes dumping site after, on the one hand, in the downstream of the dam, they are just keeping the river dry, and along with this, they are just dumping the muck which is coming out of this exit tunnel, and they are just pounding it here. If we see the condition of this social displacement of the people, more than about 54,000 families have been displaced, and in the total length of 155 kilometer reservoir, and submerging the area of 252,000 square hectare. Then is a conditions of some major projects in Himachal Pradesh which has created disturbance in physical environment, as well as reroute the rivers of Himachal. By rerouting the rivers of Himachal, it's a greater impact on the ecology and the natural routings of the rivers. Is a conditions of this Ravi basin in Chamba district of Himachal Pradesh, from where I'm coming. As a condition, and this has created, you can see the total diversion of more than 41 kilometer. Ravi has been rerouted, and either it's a drive or rerouted somewhere. It is a total length of the Ravi where these power projects have been created, and total length is 50 kilometer. River has been dried totally. It is the area which has been impounded by water by just putting 29 creating 29 kilometer big reservoir, and it's a today earthquake is a normal phenomenon in this region, and almost in every month after the creation of this project in 1994, we are experiencing many major jolt of this earthquake in our area. Now it is being said that it is based on this it is for the national interest. For at what cost is national interest? It is obvious. Are not against, or rather no one is against, just to create this such modern amenity. And we are aware that hydropower generation only can be done in the high reaches of Himalaya because of the availability of water. But it should be sustainable. It should be a way to bring such a significant advancement in human development, and we should be economically viable, socially equitable, and environmentally friendly. The last line would be, everything can be generated, what water cannot. Therefore, we must use this wonderful gift of nature with distributive justice and by taking care the future generation into consideration. Otherwise, in coming time, there will be no water, there will be no electricity, and there will be no human life as well. It's a destructive picture of this demise of this power project. Thank you very much for your patience listening. Thank you.
Thank you very much. May I now request Professor Vivek to make his presentation?
Namaskar. Respected chairperson, colleagues, delegates, and friends. It has been an honor and privilege to be here today, to have been invited for this plenary session by the authorities and the organizing secretary of this international seminar, historic international seminar conference organized by this university. My title of the presentation is Upholding and Unfolding of an Engagement Between Society, Warping Garbage and Environment. I will not go into the details of it, but I'll just give a highlight and finish it within a few minutes. You would agree with me that the clean water, proper sanitation, personal hygiene, and good nutrition are the four foundations of public health policy in any society. In Indian context, it seems to be that these foundations are least attended to. The present-day digital and fast food era has compounded the problem. Other day, somebody mentioned to me that every gift wrapping is garbage in waiting. Now, and we have seen how this garbage in waiting has been creating problem. Professor has been already talked to us about the how shortage of water will be there. We are already seen during the memorial lecture. Professor Joshi was talking about the 1 centimeter increase in the water level of pollution, and we require to buy water today. Earlier, whenever we used to go to anybody's place, you would be getting water free. Now you have to buy that water and bottled water. Imagine the other day when somebody told me in Delhi that you have to buy a can of oxygen to breathe if you want to really save yourself. Otherwise, the weather is very bad. Now, and rightly speaking, when we talk about the wrapping, gift wrapping is kind of a garbage in waiting. It is the kind of a thing that we bury under the in the bin. Talk about the slivers of memories of influence of Western culture and the dark foliage of the future. There seems to be a critical deficiency in the most cities in the country in terms of waste collection, processing, and disposal of facilities and average and sewage treatment. The garbage, waste, trash, junk, and the list of synonyms of the discarded remnants of our daily lives continue to grow in the, which adds the artifacts to its ever-growing list. The discards may longer be useful to us, but our trash is actually a treasure trove of artifacts revealing the chinks in the modern human conditions and the evolution of Western culture. In fact, we have been guided by what professor, linguistic professor of America was talking about the manufacturing consent, Noam Chomsky. Today we are living in a world wherein the digital world, wherein we are made to believe that certain things are required to be adopted and required to be taken. And in this sense, that we find that the most of our, be it so-called policy of the Green Revolution, or now the hybrid seeds, or the other kind of a so-called availability of available the aerated water and aerated drinks, we find that most of these have eaten up our own social resources, including water. Look at the kind of issues that we have faced because of the Plachimada, that Coca-Cola factory in some parts of Kerala, wherein almost 3 lakh bottles of Coca-Cola was being manufactured and almost 35 acres of land had depleted the groundwater resources. The other thing, for example, in the name of employment, we were told that pesticide, a factory in Bhopal, what it called the UCC, or Union Carbide Corporation, manufacturing of the ever-ready cells, that created such a havoc, you may recall, in the same December month of 1984. The almost 5,000 people were overnight killed because of the gas leakage by that particular company. And this was basically because of the fact that this unwanted factory which was leaking its gas, MIC gas, from California was shunted over here because it was giving problem to them. So India was a better place for manufacturing that kind of a thing. And we ended up killing this 5,000 people all of a sudden. In Mumbai, for example, some of you must have visited a place called Malwani, wherein now it is no more a dump, garbage dump, but it is now a fantastic Inox in-orbit mall has come up there. And in that in-orbit mall, next to that, there is a 3G building housing almost some offices over there, wherein all the building, entire building is of all the offices, wherein all the computers were there, and suddenly you find one fine morning the computer stopped functioning. And what was the reason? The reason was that some of our investigations found that it is because of the leaches that was coming out, the gases which were coming out from that landfill had stopped the particular the computer. Finally, the Munzur Corporation had to investigate the matter and found out that it is a treatment was not done by the builder before building that particular building, and these companies which were holding these number of offices over there had to suffer for almost 8 days because of the leaches coming up and giving the immediate cause of gas. Now, such kind of a gases, and therefore, most of the cities and urban centers, there is unhealthy climatic conditions, be it in Mumbai city or any other place. In fact, official records show that no city in the country is clean and healthy in Indian context. Dioxin, mercury, lead, and other such factors which go into the sand, go into the dustbin, or go into the landfills, have created such big havoc. Some of you must be aware that there is something called the greater patch, garbage patch, which has been found in almost all the oceans in the world, that is all the 5 major oceans, including Indian Ocean, and it was found in 2010 that Anna Kumins found that these garbage gas, are basically all the bottles and plastics and everything else which was thrown in the sea is being collected, and it is almost becoming a kind of a threat to the marine life, and that has been one of the major problems which you find. As a result, what you observe is that not only the water, not only the kind of a sand. By the way, in Mumbai, there is no sand available. You have to buy sand from outside. What is available there, even the vegetation which grows is besharmi. There is one plant called besharmi which grows without soil and that kind of a thing. Now, it is therefore, what you find is that even the vegetables which are grown around, if you have seen Mumbai city, along the railway line, there have been coriander and other things are being grown over there, are basically the sewage water which has been running around, is being used, and I don't know how many kind of chemicals and things are being taken up there. Not only that, for the purpose of human consumption, you find that there is gutkas and tobaccos are being consumed, and with a different kind of a flavor. At one time in Mumbai, there were 40 sachets of gutkas were available, including Mushaffar, Mujarrab. Now, what is that famous the president of Musharraf Gutka. Musharraf Gutka was one of the last one which I happened to see. Now, what is happening is that these kind of things are being made to believe that by having that you get good memory, good kind of thoughts, etc. And people are made to consume right from the school age. In Gujarat, if you go, there is all these things are available. In Maharashtra, a lot of places, including Kolhapur. And imagine the kind of a thing when people spit out. And by the way, everyone spits after eating one time, whatever gutka or paan, people eat at least 5 times. And each time, 3 ml, 5 times 15 ml. And 15 ml multiplied by 20% of the population of this city, if you calculate, it comes to almost about 1.5 lakh. Or let us say 2 lakh people, 20% public, if we calculate, will have a kind of a area covered by this particular thing is almost 42 times we can cover this much area of the city of Kolhapur. Now, if this is the kind of a condition, you can imagine the kind of a diseases, the smell that you, the breathing that you take, the water that you drink, the kind of food that we take, everything contaminated, and that is what the kind of a thing that is there. Now, what is the solution? Solution is very simple, as our professor first presentation has already pointed out. The policy level thing has to be decided. And unless we come at the policy level, maybe analyze the kind of a content, think about how to implement it, and what are the effects of these, it will not be possible to really make it possible to have these issues resolved. And therefore, we must have a concern at every level, whether it is a college, school, university, at every level, we must have these issues discussed and decided. Thank you very much.
So I thank Professor Dol Yuan Jiang, Dr. Mohendra Silaria, and Professor Vivek. We are now, done with this plenary session, and it has raised certain questions as well as issues for us to ponder over. Due to the time constraint, we had to cut short the presentations. However, I think whatever we have learned from those presentations are enough for us to deliberate upon and think of how best we could stop this harm to our environment. Thank you very much and good evening. Now I leave it to the organizers to come and announce the next program.
I am here for total thanks of this session. On behalf of the Department of Sociology and Shivaji University, Kolhapur, first of all, I am very much thankful to Professor R. Indira Madam for successful conduct the session. Also, I put out my sincere thanks to Professor Dai Chiong, Director Asia Climate Change Education Center, South Korea, for his resourceful talk on environment and climate change. A special thanks to Professor P.S. Vivek for his wonderful talk on environment, garbage and environment. I sincere thanks to Professor Mohinder Slaharia for his excellent talk on development, environment and climate change. I also thankful to all senior professors, Professor Uttamra Mohite sir, Professor R.P. Patil sir, and all senior professors, research scholars and students. Lastly, with the permission of chairperson, I declare here function is over. Thank you very much.
There is an announcement that whoever is attending the conference, registration is compulsory, as well as no entry in the food court without your identity cards. I repeat, no entry in the food court without your identity cards. And if you are attending the conference, registration is compulsory. Thank you.